Next, I would like to introduce our second keynote speaker this morning, Dr. David Coon, with great pleasure. He's been a friend and colleague of mine for over 20 years. Dr. Coon is Associate Vice Provost and Professor in the College of Nursing and Health Innovation at Arizona State University. He received his PhD from Stanford University in Counseling Psychology and was at that time, after that, the Associate Director of the Older Adult and Family Center at the Palo Alto VA and Stanford University School of Medicine. He's also been a research scientist at UCSF Mount Zion Institute on Aging. Currently, Dr. Coon designs and evaluates intervention programs such as CarePro and EPIC that you'll hear about that focus on culturally diverse groups of midlife and older adults facing a variety of chronic illnesses, including dementia, also cancer, depression, and family caregivers, so the partners, the individuals who assist in their care. And several of the empirically based treatments that he developed and evaluated are recognized as such by the American Psychological Association and the Administration on Aging. Dr. Coon is a fellow of the Gerontological Society of America, and his work has been funded by federal and foundation grants. He and his colleagues received the prestigious Rosalind Carter 2013 National Leadership Award in Caregiving for the CarePro program. And the title of his talk is Dementia Care, Considerations for LGBT Affirming Assessment, Support, and Resource Provision. So, Dr. Coon.
Well, thank you very much. Some of you have seen me going in and out today. I got a little sick on the way here, and so I've been trying to not be too disruptive by coughing ad nauseum, but I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. I'm going to ask, and nobody has to self-disclose that doesn't want to self-disclose, but I want to get a little bit of a feel of who's in the room. And the nice piece is that I could sit out and listen because you have speakers outside so you can hear the presentations. But how many allies do I have here, my straight ally folks here? It's nice to see some healthy numbers of straight allies. And any folks that want to identify as part of the LGBT community, feel free. Okay. All right. So we've got a nice mixture. How many people? Yeah. And how many? And I sound like I'm going through puberty. But how many? Lord. On YouTube. Thank you. So how many folks are family members, friends, currently that are providing care for someone either with dementia or some other chronic illness? Okay. How many people have done that in the past? And how many people are providers and also have done that? So it's really fascinating to me how we see this worlds collide in yet a different way, and we're still struggling to find ways to continue to make our way forward. So I'm going to zip through a lot of things in your packet because in sort of getting a feel for what other people were talking about, I added things at the end. Sorry, it happens. But you have to turn in your slides a ways ahead of time, and then you sort of tweak accordingly. I'm going to talk a little bit about key issues in dementia care and caregiving, then why it's important for us to think about LGBT issues related to this. I'm going to mention a few frameworks, and Karen really did a fabulous job of talking about some of the things that go into these frameworks, and you've got copies of those, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the details in those, and I just have a few examples, but what I really want to talk about some is some call for action. Some call for action for folks that are here, ways that all of us can think about being engaged in issues associated with LGBT care for individuals with cognitive impairment. I think it's critical, the number one consideration in talking about resources and assessment and tools and all these kinds of things is something called family caregiving. And when we talk about it today, we're talking about family. We're not talking about family, all right? And everybody that's a member of the LGBT community knows what I'm saying when I talk about family, right? Okay, so that's what we're going to spend time talking about. But what I love is that the CDC back in 2008 really said that family caregiving is a public health priority. And why is that? It's down here in pink. Large burden, major impact, respect to healthcare costs and consequences, but also a potential for prevention. A potential for prevention to deal with the kinds of issues that get raised. I'm going to talk in general about caregiving. Caregivers are the hidden patient, these informal people that sit behind. Many of you who raised your hand know what I'm talking about. You can be impacted with the blues and even clinical depression. Anxiety, anger, frustration. What's for dinner? What's for dinner? What's for dinner? Feeling a little frustrated. Yeah, okay, it happens, all right? We love this person, but the reality is it can get on our nerves because we're human beings. All right, and caregivers are great with the G word, the guilt word, right? Okay, we can get ourselves into guilt in a New York minute, right? Financial loss, social isolation. And it's not like we all arrive with, you know, a clean bill of health. I didn't today, that's for sure. But I mean, we don't arrive to caregiving without our own issues, okay? Because, and they can be impacted by the kinds of stress that goes along with that. And Rich Schultz back in 1999, his colleagues demonstrated that stressed caregivers, and this is important, stressed caregivers could be at risk for mortality. There have been other studies that have come out since then suggesting that maybe there's actually a hardiness effect and a resilience effect, but the issue is stress. And we know stress kills, right? So I don't want to get in the big debate about whether or not caregiving is, you know, a hardiness factor or what. It's about stress. So it's about us finding ways to get that under control. The value of family caregiving is incredible. If we take every one of you that did what you did and pay you for that, and we do that across dementia, 2013, 15.5 million Americans provided $17.5 billion in unpaid care. That's $220 billion in 1 year. Give yourselves a round of applause. And the providers that stand behind you. We are saving those people, those yahoos in Washington. Oh, I'm on tape. Those yahoos in Washington. Did I say that? I did. I could say it again. All right. All right. So it's the most important source for people. All right. Without this source, our entire long-term supportive services system would collapse. If you all didn't do what you do, we're toast. Family caregivers have to do so much more than they used to in the past. You know, sometimes people will say, well, isn't this what grandma did for grandpa back in the 30s? No. First off, he was 56, and he'd fallen off the farm truck. Okay, that's a whole different way of providing care at an acute incident, right? We're talking about people lasting for a long period of time and trying to find ways to balance the quality of life of both these individuals in a very serious way. There's something that's called the internet, and it is the devil. Don't you love it? Dr. Coon, I was looking on the internet. I feel the stress go into my chest immediately because you've got to find some way to be able to address whatever is going to come out. I was looking at this blue aqua whatever, and I'm wondering if you think that might cure dementia. Probably not. Okay. So anyway, we've got to handle these things. It's a critical tipping point. What caused it to be stressful? I think there are four key things. Lack of control and predictability. There's a lot of unusual behaviors and things that go along with this. It's an upside-down sawtooth curve. It's not as if people just sort of have this nice little change a little bit every day. No, it goes up and down, and that is part of what's so maddening for people that are caring for individuals with dementia. Loss of outlets for social support, okay? And we'll get back to that. Perception that things are getting worse, because they are. It's a progressive dementia. You know, when somebody says to me, you know, Dr. Krim, my dad's getting worse. And I'm like, I know that's true. I know that's true. But how helpful is it for you to run that through your mind? Weren't you telling me that a couple of days ago about your day in the park and how you connected? Why don't we concentrate on that instead of spend time thinking about the fact that it is a progressive dementia? We have to be prepared. But let's not spend our time totally in that moment. Feeling we don't have what it takes to step up to the plate. I call this the caregiving chair. You know, people wake up in the morning, they hear someone stirring, and there's like, wait, right? So they get in that caregiving chair, and they go like this. Can you hear me on YouTube? And you can't. Too bad. Anyway, And then you get exhausted and you go to sleep at night, okay? But that is everybody. Let's add on top, I'm so bad about standing behind the mic. Dolores knows this. All right, I cannot stand still. It's not, it's just not. But how long is the cord? This works for who? Oh, I love you. I loved her before, but I love her even more now. Do I have to turn this one off? No? No, do I have to turn this one off? No? My mic guy probably has it all handled back there. Anyway, okay. So I'm not going to hit this ton, but I want to acknowledge my colleague and friend, Karen, for really starting to bring to the forefront issues that are going on. You know, why is it important? Because we are recognizing that there are differences. Differences in disability, differences in impact. She hit this in her talk, okay? And even though there are sampling issues and things she's talking about, she's now designed a study to really help answer those kind of questions and begin to disentangle that in a very powerful way. But what I want to remind people, alarming amounts of disability, depression, loneliness, but also about victimization. Okay, this powerful overlay in the LGBT community that I'm sorry, but, you know, my parents live in a, you know, medium-sized town in northeastern Oklahoma, and, you know, they've got a very strong social support, church faith-based network. It's a little bit different, perhaps, for some of the people that are isolated there who are members of the LGBT community, okay? I should pick up my hometown, but, you know, I'm just saying, it's different than San Francisco, don't you think? Okay. Also, who's caring for whom? You start to look at this impact, and you start to say, and I mean, how many people as providers walk into a situation and you're like, okay, who's really the caregiver and who's really the person that needs the assistance? Okay, it's a unit, right? Everybody that's a provider in the room knows this, okay? And they may be differential levels of in and out of the closet. There may be differential levels of acknowledgement of what the dementia is. All of these kinds of things. I missed that, whatever that was. And then I think it's interesting to see that we do have much more of a difference in terms of many more men in the LGBT community are engaged in caregiving. And I think in part that has to not only to do with their partnerships and their friendship networks, but it also has to do with our reality of facing what we faced in the AIDS crisis, right? And our reaching out and our connections in that. So we got to remember, too, that about a third of us provide care to a friend. And so I think that's critical differences in things we think about. And we've already talked today about the need, ongoing need to understand through more research about all these kinds of things. I'm going to present a few frameworks, okay? Just a few frameworks to talk about how for you all to think about some of the things that Karen has raised and you all face on an everyday basis. And this is a model, a couple of models I developed. One's called the CHESS model. And it's really thinking about our contextual considerations. So some of the issues that Karen raised at the end of her talk, some of the things that Michelle raised in her talk, how do we think about the cultural, historical, employment, financial, legal, the social support, and spiritual aspects? And so you have these frameworks in your packets. And what I think is important is we have to remember that there is as worlds collide, of people of different overarching cultural backgrounds come in and are part of the LGBT community, how that interface works and how we need to communicate and think about them in a family-centered care kind of way, okay? Family-centered care kind of way is critical. We have to consider that there is a lot of prohibition about how things are mentioned or how things are talked, or even in language, what words are used as identifiers that in English would be viewed very negatively, but perhaps in that language is not viewed very negatively. And we have to hear their voices and understand that. It influences whether or not people withhold or present information and how much they do. The historical context, so back to the issue of cohort. I was really struck when I was here And I did some work in HIV over 50, and we ran a series of focus groups. And I was really blown away as a person who was the mean age of the epidemic at that time, that we had guys who were 65 and older that were not impacted at all in the same way that I was. They had, in their sense, their friends were older, many of them were partnered, and they knew very few people, even living in the Bay Area, who they had lost AIDS. I lost many more than they did in listening to that. So that may seem very odd, but now as we had these other cohorts like me, okay, 50, I'm almost 57. It's not a secret. Okay, so anyway, we have to think about these, but how the influence of women's liberation, the civil rights movement, comes together with Stonewall. And how that influences cohorts, and how it might not have influenced somebody who grew up in Western Kansas. Okay? How it may not have impacted them in the same way. Employment, financial, legal context. Karen hit some of these. It's critical that we think and we get information. While some things have been proved, are you watching the news? Are you watching the potential backlash? It's there. Gosh, I'm going to love this on YouTube as I sound like I'm 14. All right. Actually, oh no, I can't say that. Dang you recording. Anyway, social support context. We have to remember that we need to understand this individual's views or this couple's view or this family's view of what their support system is about, not impose on top that it does not exist or that we have certain assumptions of what exists. Comes back to what Karen said. The biological family may be incredibly supportive. They may not be. Okay. And then the spiritual context. If you all don't know, survey after survey, when it comes to informal care, suggests the number one coping resource for people is religious or spiritual coping. But when you go into the LGBT community, the reconfiguration of spirituality and what it means and how it's utilized is quite different. And it may be much more in the non-organizational religiosity side. That is, I don't attend a specific church or synagogue or temple, but rather I do it in a different way. And how do we utilize that? Another framework, real quickly, that I want to go through that I think would help you organize some of the information that Karen and Michelle presented as well is what I call the discuss model. We have to remember that discrimination and insensitivity and the harassment that we've talked about is woven through all these different levels. But this is really drawn from some work really done by Karen Emmons and some other folks way back in looking at in like 2003 or 2004 about how we need to think about interventions across multiple levels. We have to figure out how not only we help change behavior when we need to, but how we maintain that change over time. That's what's really hard. And I think one of the ways to do that is to weave things and interventions across these multiple levels of intervention. So again, you have some examples of potential barriers. I won't go back through the discrimination types of things that we've talked about, because I want to get on. But Karen mentioned, how do we have this safe place? We see those symbols. But what does that mean? And when does your organization need a tune-up about that? And remember, there's diversity within that LGBT community. So is it really that you're safe for gay men, but not so much for everybody else? Okay, so we need to see what is the reality of that and what we need to do. So on the individual level, there are examples of barriers, and then there's opportunities to really overcome that. So we talked about this issue of level of outness, and we need to remember that level of outness varies, as Karen said, and she said it in one way, I'm going to say it in a little bit of another, and that is that it varies, too, from context to context. People can be very out, kind of socially, but they're not at work. They're not going to deny it if it's talked about at work or if somebody confronts them at work, but they're not really out at work in the same way that I'm out at work. Well. And on YouTube. Anyway, okay. But what I always found fascinating is really working, particularly with couples, where there was this differential level
And when you start to throw dementia into that mix, it becomes very complicated about figuring out what the scripts are and how to help them with those scripts, because it's our jobs to understand that, but also help them with that script, those of us that are providers, about who to say what to whom regarding that. So do we have our referrals in place? Do we have things ready to go? And I think there can be systems and organizational changes. Again, we continue to see some improvement in terms of non-discrimination issues, but you know, there's stuff that I always say that's on the books, and then there's the reality of when you walk through the door. Okay? And I think that's critical for all of us to remember. And sometimes some of us who work in incredibly open and affirming environments lose sight of the fact that, oh yeah, well that company or organization is listed. But you talk to people in that company or organization, and a lot of them don't feel that it's all that safe to be there, no matter what's written on the books. So we still have a lot of work to do with that. We have to think about our communities and what that means. You know, is it a community that is a senior housing community? Is it a community that is a certain neighborhood? What is our community, and how do we begin to embed the policy changes and the types of individual changes with the organizational changes that exist in that community or serve that community with the things that can be done within that community as a whole? Where are the safe zones, safe spaces for people to be there? You know, many times when you hear seniors in general, but also particularly in the LGBT community, there's fear of being attacked, okay? Where are the safe places in our hoods? Where do you go quickly if you need it? You know, where's, it's not the Kmart blue light special, but you know you're talking about. You're in the parking lot and there's that blue light over there, right? So where are those kinds of things? And I don't think we do great jobs of some of these very basic things that would help people feel much safer at the community level. And then there's the policy level. You know, marriage equality is a wonderful thing, but have you listened to the news? Okay, it's kind of scary, right? And the level of differences that still exist across states and the populations within those states in terms of what they're thinking about. Okay, so you've got examples, and by these in no way cover all of them, and you know, I've written things before that have more in them, but that you can find easily on the internet, and probably, Kathy, you still got them up at Family Caregiver Alliance, some of those things? Yeah, okay. See Kathy in the back. Big champion of this. For many, many, many years, Family Caregiver Alliance. Emerging promises, practices. You know, there are things like this. I am so happy to be part of this, but we also have to figure out what are the things that get sustained and keep going on. What Michelle mentioned in open house in terms of what the trainings are that they're being able to do. How do we evaluate those? How do we market those? How do we let people know about them? You know, emerging promises, practices, and information referral, published material, these kinds of workshops and forums, support groups and counseling, but we still need some additional formal evaluation of things. If we look, and Dolores and I have done a number of these kinds of reviews, the last one, they want us to do another one, don't they? Yeah, so the last one we did was 2012, but when we really look at informal caregiving, supporting the people in the room that are informal caregivers about what's most successful, I think the thing that never makes me popular with so many people that are trying their very best in the community is that the things at the top that are most available have the least evidence that they change behavior and sustain behavior change. That actually, when we teach people skills on how to manage their stress, manage their situation, communicate more effectively, do those kinds of things with some of those, then we actually see behavior change and potential maintenance of behavior change. And we need to figure out how to do this more effectively in the community. Now, this is a model that I did. I, for about 7 years, Edie, where's Edie? There's Edie. About 7 years, and for the Alzheimer's Association, I ran an LGBT support group, one of the first ones in the nation. I took over for Steve, whose name's going to escape me because I'm got a lot of cold medication in me right now. But again, on YouTube, dang. So So anyway, but I think there's ways to begin to embed some of the skill changing at identifying unhelpful behaviors, unhelpful thoughts, and how to reframe those, and how to utilize and have people change and think differently in their situation. I have also on your handout a few things that you, just a question that you can ask yourself at each one of the levels that I mentioned. And this can go across not just in the LGBT community. The reason these questions are sort of framed the way that they are is to think about the diversity that we have in the LGBT community, and not just those four letters, but when we intersect with race and ethnicity and socioeconomic status and all these other kinds of things that come in. But, you know, if you're going to intervene, what are your personal values and beliefs? What have you set down? Have you within your have you within your organization set down? When you're feeling uncomfortable, when you've met someone new, you know, is there a moment to pause about whether that person is a part of a group, and do you need to explore that a little bit and think about that differently? Interpersonal, how do you behave towards those differently that are in dyads or groups as a whole? You as a group, you know, you as your social group, you know, how do you look at those kinds of things and ask those questions? And then as an organization, as your systems, partners, and policies, how does my agency favor particular groups? How do we, who often are organizations that are serving the LGBT community, and we have limited funds, and I appreciate all that, but how do we also make sure that we have the interface with all the straight allies that are in the room? You know, how do we make certain that we have those connections to build a more powerful a society as a whole? And then how do we go from change agent as an individual to change agency? What in the community encourages a view of superiority, and how do we change that? How do we get us on an even playing field and stay on an even playing field, connecting with others? And then what policies or practices do exist within my organization, but then within the government, within policies of the places that I work, et cetera, that defoster diversity instead of embrace it? Deep breath. I got 10 minutes to get through the other stuff that you don't have, okay? All right, and what I'm gonna do is, back in 2003, Will Ryder, right, Kathy? Will and I did a little survey, and what I was struck by is that Karen and Marcy and folks have done one in 2013. This was done back, and these are users, and these are proportions of caregivers and care recipients. And look at those, and this is in the Bay Area, those that experienced insensitivity, discrimination, harassment from providers, almost 50% of the caregivers, and almost 25% of the care recipients. Sometimes care recipients are like, I just gotta keep my mouth shut, I gotta get in there, I gotta get what I gotta get, okay? Did not seek help because of felt like they had to conceal their sexuality. We've got, you know, over a quarter of the people. We've got still healthy proportions in the 2013 survey, correct? Yep. So did not seek help because of their concern about harassment. And it sort of flips. This is interesting, where this person isn't gonna go, those that go, less, but there are those that aren't going because they don't want to experience this. And the reverse is up here, because often this person is the cultural broker for this individual. You see how that all connects? Interesting, huh? We had, you know, quotes from some of these people. My partner's family have turned their backs. It's been a long, tiring, very hard with his decision, the fact that 30-some years ago he came out as a gay man, right? I was told you two were on your own. 30 years they're holding on to that, right? I'm shocked by how little most LGBT people know about the community resources and how little community resource professionals know about LGBT issues. So part of the reason we continue to have these kinds of things to raise the awareness. Hard to find help at first, and we as a gay couple weren't talked to as a couple by friends, by family, and especially as doctors. Transphobia in society is also in the nursing home environment. How many times do I have to listen to my partner being called he by staff? How stupid. And you think, really? I mean, that should be in a chart, that should be whatever, just like that and done, right? Can I hear a right?
Right. Yeah.
Kind of crazy. All right, so here's my 10 minutes.
I took two more. All right. Hey, Karen got more than that. I love you, Karen. So here's what I think we need to start thinking about. We can change it. And what I mean is, you know what? Too much of the time, we're trying to figure out how we work in this larger world. Mm-mm. We've got stuff that we are able to do and handle. How much healthcare learned from what we have gone through in HIV and AIDS? Okay? How much social science has learned of that? So the same thing's here. I want to change it from successful aging to aging successfully, because successful aging suggests you can fail. Hey, we got what we got. How do we take what we got and do the best we can with it? That means we're going to do healthy aging. But it also means healthy sexuality. We have bad models about sexuality, and I loved what Michelle said earlier. I love this fact that we are sexualized. Gosh, why am I still dateless on a Friday night? But anyway, you know, so we're constantly in that sense, sort of that's raised the, you know, there. And then older folks don't have these. So it's ridiculous. But I'd also like, no offense to the Stanford Geriatric Education Center, but Dolores and I talked about this last night. You know, I'm so tired of geriatric and elderly and everything that implies something different from an aging continuum. There's a variety of disabilities and challenges and illnesses that happen across the lifespan. Let's talk about the continuum of life, and let's talk about aging. Aging starts at birth and goes all the way across. Let's not label people as geriatric and elderly and this or that, okay? Because it's just a problem.
We're changing our name.
Yeah, good. Excellent. Excellent. So we need to think about prevention. We need to think about, you stole a minute of my time. Prevention, treatment, and care. We need to talk about prevention, treatment, and care. And we need to not just be focused on the physical health. Behavior change is about changing how we think and what we do and creating systems in social health as well that help support those kinds of changes. We have to get there. We can't just say, you come and you get treated for your physical condition, you're on your way. Workforce, this has been addressed some too. But we, you know, interprofessional, we, the LGBT community and our straight allies can do this. How do we show them how to do interprofessionalism? And I don't mean a new house that looks just like the old house, only there's a different person at the top of that house. I'm talking about true interprofessionalism, okay? So now what does that translate into? When we usually think about the healthcare team, who's the leader? Okay. Okay, but that's my two debates. Okay, so on the one hand, an interprofessional team doesn't imply that one person is in charge of that team. And as the case changes, we don't necessarily need the same person in charge. A team means a team, okay? How do we build that team, not just with professionals, but what did I talk about for the first however many minutes of this presentation? Informal caregivers, all of those people that raised their hand, you are a critical member of the team, as is the individual impacted. Culturally responsive. You know, I struggle over the years of culturally competent, culturally this, you know, it's hard to know. Competency seems like you arrive, and that always bothers me. Culturally responsive means that I am really in the trenches with you. I am with you. I am not teaching you. I am not this or that. I am with you in this dialogue to move forward, to respond effectively. 5 minutes. Bridging the healthcare and LTSS gap. We can do this too. What do I mean by that? Healthcare's over. I used to think that the biggest gap was the provider and the patient. Then I decided it was the provider and the family caregiver. Then I decided, well, you know, I don't know. What I really think the biggest gap is these days is the gap between health care or sick care and care that is provided or should be provided that's about prevention and whatever, and mental health and social health care that's part of the long-term supportive services network, the services side of that, social services side. That gap has got to be done. Family, broaden it, chosen, and you gotta avoid the toxics. Is all social support good? Hell no.
And this isn't just about, this isn't just about LGBT. How many straight people in here had some sister come in and fly in for the weekend and tell them what the hell was wrong with what they were doing with mom when they hadn't been there for, you know, the last 365 days, right? Amen. Amen? Okay. So we can do that too, because we know we need to avoid the toxics. We need to identify who they are, and we give them the internet to look something up. Hello, Benny, it's your mother. I only have a minute. Get married, have children, goodbye. We had a lot in common. I was in love with him, and he was in love with him. Now, there are appropriate ways to deal with this. I am not sanctioning firearms in any way, shape, or form. I'm back to we need to develop effective interventions and target them as well to the greater community. We often talk about that book, Kath Weston's Family We Choose, Lesbians, Gays, and Kinship. My family is really both. It's my nuclear, my blood family, and it's the gay and lesbian family Todd and I chose together here in the city and from back home years ago. Many of them are still with us. They are our champions. Again, from that survey. Voice, advocate, and be an advocate. How do we have the person with dementia as well as the care partner voice be heard? Carol Whitlatch and I have been, and really Carol has led this from Benjamin Rose Institute, but as part of EPIC, we've developed ways to begin to understand how do we help the early stage individual voice their values from the beginning while they still can, so you know. What's more important, for you to know what your values are as the caregiver or to know what the person who you're caring for's values are? It's more important to know their values. And the same thing, to know who do they want to help take care of them. The self, by the way, is the caregiver, family caregiver. So typically, this is why caregivers are so burdened. Every care task, everybody assumes, including the person with dementia, thinks is going to be handled by that family member. How do we voice how we can move those over time to other people? It is about the ethic of care. Nell Noddings, I worked for her when I was at Stanford, when she was dean of the school there. You know, it's the balance between the quality of life of the individual impacted by the illness and the quality of life of the family or care net that is trying. It's balancing those two things, and that is critical. And anybody that wants to get in the way of whoever wants to do that, and we're family, so if we show them how to do this as family, I can't tell you how many straight people will be singing our praises because they feel the same way. Many of them talk about how their friends have stepped up and helped them in a way that some family members did not across the course of this illness. What do we want? It's simple, and this is from understanding issues facing LGBT Americans. We want to earn a living and provide for ourselves and our family. We want the ability to pursue health and happiness, the ability to be safe in our communities, opportunity to serve our country in whatever way that means, okay? And the ability to take care of the ones we love. That's what we want. I want to end with this. Not too bad, huh?
Very good.
Just saying, right? The truly strong in our society, the truly strong are those who reach out for support, whether the abscess is on the knee or the soul. Okay? Buck up, people. The truly strong actually reach out. They don't suffer in silence. Anybody care to guess who that might be, who that quote is? What, did I put you to sleep? What? Rona Barrett, gossip columnist. Now, part of the reason I put that up there, it is one of my favorite quotes. And I am constantly reminded that I have to listen. I have to listen. Because listening, as the Dalai Lama says, you might actually learn something. When you're speaking, you're only sharing what you already know. All right? When you listen, you might actually learn something. Courage is the willingness to face the unexpected, for that is what defines it. Courage is the willingness to face the unexpected, to get up every day as a person with dementia, to get up every day as a family member caring for that, to get up every day as a provider who's going to help that unit move forward, is to face the unexpected. That's courage, okay? Individuals facing chronic illness or impairment, their caregivers or care partners, and the care net that support them as LGBT members or allies are incredibly courageous. So I thank you for your time. And am I supposed to do questions? Or?
Hey, thank you so much, Dr. Coon, for sharing your experiences and your amazing perceptions of things on YouTube for all of us.
Can you go back to your slide on the equal opportunity in America? Do you have any more thoughts on that?
Well, I think that... Do I have any more thoughts? I think that every single one of those, if we do the types of interventions that we're talking about, you know, when we go back to the frameworks that I was mentioning, if we go in and we figure out how to begin to intervene with some of the kinds of suggestions that are there as well as others, then we are better positioned to achieve that. I think, truthfully, and I'm probably still on YouTube, but that's okay. My family will forgive me for this one. About 8 or 9 years ago, I was home for the holidays, and LGBT issues came up, and I looked at everyone in the room and said, you know, I don't have rights. You can talk about special interest or whatever. I don't have rights till you decide I have rights, because I'm not the majority. It's as simple as that. So I can advocate, but I need you to advocate. So all of these kinds of things, we have to figure out across those multiple levels of intervention, how we weave that together. And that's what I'm talking about. When we talk about behavior change at the individual level and maintenance of those, we're talking about then we need behavior change within the broader system of family. We need behavior change within our organizations and our systems and connect, so that gap that I talked about, that's what's gonna help lead to these types of opportunities and basic rights still. Let's be clear, right? Those are pretty basic. Does that help? Well, I agree. I think in some ways we have to figure out ways to help have all different types of messages, but we need to change the message. And part of that, my statement about the call to action at the end, is we need to think about our constant contributions as a community with our straight allies and partners, and how we can demonstrate models and change that others are going to benefit from. And as that, we are equally deserving in these points. So somebody else had I think that, where's Michelle? So it was a question about trans resources, and I would like to think about older adults in particular. So Your training and focus, and I think there are things that have come out of the National Gay and Lesbian Task Force and a variety of places that people could look on the net that have some good training resources. Did you have anything in particular that you wanted to say about what your training does in terms of trans and transphobia?
We do definitely include trans issues in our training. And there is also an organization called Forge, or Transgender Aging Network, out of Minnesota, is it? Or Minneapolis? Yeah, Minnesota. Run by Larry Cook Daniels, and there's tons of resources on that website, as well as the NRC national website. It does. It's about aging trans people, as well as the NRC website has tons of information about trans aging.